there is a lot of need to create awareness among both parents and teachers about learning disabilities, about the role that they can play, about compensating advantages of these children, about having inclusive classroom strategies. So even in the classroom, a teacher can, you know, introduce teaching methodologies that benefit these children and actually help all the children. So, like, you know, I mean, awareness is at the core. And like, you know, when we talk to teachers about the or people in intervention centers, that the biggest complaint or the biggest issue that they talk about is the unwillingness of parents to accept. So even when the teacher would tell them that, you know, I think you should get your child screened or assessed for this, most of the time parents are not, you know, willing to take it forward because they really do not know about it. So what they should know is that child has huge potential, you know, but they may face difficulties in academics.
Welcome to episode 8 of the Learn and Unlearn podcast, where I have a conversation with Tina Paul, founder director of Giftolexia, a startup that is helping children with learning difficulties realize their true potential. Welcome to the show, Tina. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you, Gautam.
To get started, can you please tell us about the vision behind Giftolexia?
See, children with learning disabilities do not get identified early on. The average age for identification in India is 11 to 12 to 13. So you kind of lose 5-6 years of intervention, which could really help the children. So that's why we wanted to work on a screening tool that can identify children very early on. My youngest son has got dysgraphia. He was identified at age 13. But since he, you know, got the right intervention support and support from school, he could go on to do well for himself. But a lot of children, especially, you know, from backgrounds where parents are not aware, teachers are not aware of this condition, and, you know, it leads to school dropouts. You know, children really struggle because they realize they're smart, but, you know, it's very frustrating for them when they can't do academically well. So our mission is to help children with learning disabilities by identifying them early and getting them right intervention support so that they can go on to do well and, you know, kind of realize their true potential.
True. As a layman, how do I identify that my child has learning disabilities? Are there any specific symptoms?
There are a lot of indicators, and there are some early checklists that you can look at. Like, you know, kids, some of the very prominent signs are they confuse left and right. Children do confuse left and right when they're young, but, you know, if they continue this beyond, say, class 2 or 3, or they have trouble buttoning up, they've troubled, they sometimes confuse their letters, letter reversal. So, like, you know, see, none of these are, these are, we can call them symptoms, but having them does not say that you have disability, learning disability. Not having also does not ensure that your child does not have a learning disability, because my son never, we mostly hear about letter reversals. But my son absolutely had no letter reversals. So not having letter reversal is not, not a surety that your son does not, or your child does not have a learning disability. So these are indicators. The other very, very predominant sign is your child is like really smart, but, you know, when it comes to academic performance, you feel, you know, he could do better. So that, what they say is, the child is performing below his potential. So a very aware parent can actually, see these symptoms in children and then seek professional help. So, so the kids need to be so what we do is we do an early screening. We screen children who are in primary school, class 3 to be very precise. We use a gaze pattern based screening where we make children read age and grade appropriate text on a screen. And this gaze data is analyzed using machine learning algorithms. And with predictive modeling, we are able to assess the risk level of the child. We don't term the child as dyslexic or dysgraphia or, you know, anything like that. We just say that this particular child is at a high risk of developing learning disability. So start intervention. Our basic intent is to start intervention early on so that you don't really wait for the child to fail. Because normally what happens today is, when the academic rigor increases, say class 6, 7 or 8, then the child really starts lagging behind. So that's when a lot of people try to get help. A lot of people do not really know. So, I mean, they never seek help. So they kind of, you know, the kids really, really feel frustrated. Like, I remember my son saying, I work so hard, but like, you know, why don't I get the marks?
True. What is the role of parents and teachers in dealing with such issues?
Parents and teachers have a very, very important role. So teachers often, you know, if the teacher knows about it, if the teacher is aware, a lot of studies have shown that, the awareness among teachers about learning disabilities is very low. But if the teacher is made aware, the teacher can play a very, very important role in identifying the child early on. And parents as well, if you feel your child is lagging behind in academics, it's good to understand why that is happening. So sometimes it could be due to lack of instruction in the school or some other issues. A child could have, vision issue or anything like that. But it's always good to, look at the reasons why the child's performance is not up to the mark. And for that, it's very, very important to make the teacher aware and the parents aware and aware of the compensating advantages of these children. These children do face difficulty with reading, with writing or with math, but they do have huge compensating advantages, which actually kind of get lost because we, have so much focus on academic performance. And these children are not really able to do. And it's mostly because these children learn in a slightly different way or than the chalk and talk method that's most prevalent in our schools. So they need to be taught strategies to learn better, to look at their areas of weakness and have intervention support to support areas of weakness and improve those.
Mm-hmm. What are the remediation measures followed?
Remediation is predominantly in terms of learning methodologies, which are multisensory in nature. So, if a child is finding it difficult to write, practice air writing, write on sand or rice or salt, so that the child's kind of develops. And when it comes to learning, the people that the counselors that we were meeting told us were, see, these children receive and store information in ways that are different from how we and I do. So they have to be taught to receive information and store it in a way that they can retrieve it. And I remember talking to an expert in the field. So her name is Jayanti. So she said when she was attending a conference, the person sitting next to her had a learning disability and they had to learn the names of people sitting next to them. So I think it was an international conference. So when she told her name, the other person just wrote J-N-T. So she said, so that's a strategy for that person to remember, So JNT would say JNT. So these kids, really, really smart. And once they are like, you know, the most important aspect is to not let them lose their confidence. So like, you know, so this is where early intervention is extremely important. See, a child who is in third or fourth, how they look at their academic performance and a child when the child comes to seventh or eighth is very, very different. Okay, so like, you know, the peers have a very, very important role when they say they are in like, you know, seventh or eighth grade. So they like, you know, the stress that the child feels of not doing well is it's much more as they reach higher classes. Whereas when they're in the third or fourth, they kind of take it within their stride. So if you start intervention then, they can, you know, kind of improve themselves and can go on to do well.
Absolutely. As you mentioned, children shouldn't lose their confidence and yes. they shouldn't be yes. labeled in front of their peers.
Yes. So, I mean, so there is like, you know, there is a lot of need to create awareness among both parents and teachers about learning disabilities, about the role that they can play, about compensating advantages of these children, about having inclusive classroom strategies. So even in the classroom, a teacher can, you know, introduce teaching methodologies that benefit these children and actually help all the children. So, like, you know, I mean, awareness is at the core. And like, you know, when we talk to teachers about the or people in intervention centers, that the biggest complaint or the biggest issue that they talk about is the unwillingness of parents to accept. So even when the teacher would tell them that, you know, I think you should get your child screened or assessed for this, most of the time parents are not, you know, willing to take it forward because they really do not know about it. So what they should know is their child has huge potential, you know, but they may face difficulties in academics. So, you know, how do you help the child? You know, we hear so many stories. Once a teacher told me that, you know, so there were a few kids. I think she was mentioning about two children in her class. One of the parents, they were like, you know, they accepted it, got the child assessed. And then the child was extremely, you know, good at singing. So they took him out. And then I think he went on to do NIOS, National Open Schooling. And pursued his career in music. And, you know, he kind of cleared his, you know, 10th and 12th and also was doing very well in his singing thing. Whereas the other child, the parents just refused to accept. So, you know, I mean, they blindly refused to accept. So my child can't have anything. Like, you know, I went to IIM or I went to IIT. You know, my child can't have a learning disability. So it's you're actually harming your child. And the other child's parents refuse to accept and the child struggles through school. So so that this is where, you know, the acceptance plays a role.
A mindset shift is definitely needed.
Yes. So, I mean, to see that this is not a problem, like, you know, learning disabilities actually, I mean, you know, there are one of the issues is in India, we really do not have so much research data on children with learning disabilities or on how they've gone on to do well for themselves. But abroad, there are a lot of studies and like, you know, I mean, a very interesting video that I watched. The professor talks about the student with learning disabilities having huge advantages. And he was talking about evolution. He said, so there are, you know, some genes also, there is a genetic component also to learning disabilities. So, you know, people, children whose parents or anyone in the family has a 50% higher chance of, you know, having learning disability. So this professor was talking about if it was a bad gene, if, you know, evolution would have made sure that it went away. But the fact that it still remains shows that, you know, they have huge advantages. And as a society, we have failed to capture that or we have failed to understand that. So, yes.
That's an interesting perspective of looking at it as well.
Yes.
As you mentioned, if it was a bad gene, nature would have removed it.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
Wonderful. This is a wonderful initiative which needs to be known by a lot of people.
Yes.
So how are you reaching out?
So we started our journey at NSRCell and IIM. It's part of the Women Startup Program, sponsored by Goldman Sachs. We started in mid-2017. And then so that actually, I mean, you know, being accepted by an incubator like NSRCell gave us a lot of credibility. And then we also won the Maharashtra Startup Award in 2018. And so far, we've screened over 2,000 students in Maharashtra. So our screening is language specific. So we've developed this in English and Marathi. So this kind of screening is it's available internationally. It's accepted by the British Dyslexia Association. And we're the first ones to have a technology-enabled screening. So, how our screening is different is it takes just about 5 minutes to screen a student. We screen the students in the school. And it's kids are just made to read a few sentences. So, there's absolutely no stress on the children. You know, kids kind of see this as kind of a fun exercise. We can do class-wide screening. So there is a lot of, initiatives taken at different levels. The Right to Persons with Disabilities Act considers specific learning disabilities as one of the disabilities listed there. And also the RBSK also mentions screening children for learning disabilities and giving the appropriate support. The government of Maharashtra, High Court of Bombay has passed a court ruling to screen all children before the age of 9. So all of these initiatives have, brought in a little more awareness. See, 10 or 20 years ago, you really did not really hear about learning disabilities so much. But, today it's a little more openly, talked about. There are a lot of initiatives. Initially, people would say that even I faced the same thing with my son also when he was in 11th and 12th. The teachers would say, see, he's so smart when he can answer so well. He knows so much. But, he doesn't work hard enough to, his papers, he doesn't write enough in the papers. So then I say, no, see, look, he has a learning disability. He said, no, don't talk about all of that. That's all gone. It's a lifelong condition. You just, train the kids to overcome the difficulties. It never goes away. So, the teacher needs to know about it. So there are a lot of initiatives that are happening to, start conversations around it, the policies around it. So this is actually, at least improved awareness to some extent. But again, a lot needs to be done in creating awareness, in creating research data, in making parents aware, especially when you come to the government schools or tier 2, tier 3 cities. Maybe there is a little more awareness in the urban, among the urban population, but the awareness among rural population is still very, very limited. So a lot needs to be done. So we approach different governments to adopt our screening methodology. So that's, and then we also do online intervention programs, especially during the pandemic. So we do programs in early reading, math. We also do some fun programs like storytelling, memory games. We also do a program called Kids with Passports, where kids are taken on a virtual tour of different countries. So, we talk about the culture, the language, they learn a few words in that, in that language. They talk, all of this from a child's perspective, what does a school in a particular country look like? How do they celebrate their birthday? What are the festivals they have? What are the places and things like that? So, so these are the small things that we're trying to, do from our end.
Mm-hmm. Coming back to the conversation about the professor who said that if the gene had a problem,
Yes.
Nature would, you know, take it out. So this reminds me of a saying, if you judge a fish by its ability to climb a tree, it'll yes. fail miserably.
Yes.
Each child has its own special capability.
Yes. No, it could be beyond academics. And what we feel always is because of our, you know, so much focus on academics, we fail to develop the other talents that the child may have. Maybe it could be in a sport, it could be in singing, you know, dancing, whatever area that the child wants, often gets overlooked. Because, you know, often you say, okay, you know, first you get your marks, then we will, you know, look at other areas.
This is a much needed change in the education system as well. Do you see any other such gaps in the education system where you feel certain topics or life lessons are not covered in the formal education system?
Yes, like you also mentioned, like, you know, that, you know, about financial literacy, like, you know, how kids do not get an exposure to financial literacy. Or like you rightly pointed out about, you know, how to handle emotional issues in life. I don't know, when we were growing up, we used to have a subject called as moral science. So I think that to some extent, helped, you know, the stories there, or, you know, something like that exposed us to different problems faced by people, or, you know, it was kind of a value education. So. I don't know if how many schools have that, a lot of things need to be done. So I used to previously work in an education firm. So we used to conduct these kind of programs for children in schools. So we used to, conduct programs on financial literacy in schools. We used to have programs on, I think theater, robotics, cartooning. So these kind of programs can be, even if it is not part of the curriculum, because even whenever anything becomes part of the curriculum, you look at an exam at the end, and, you know, these are, you know, some of the things that there is a more need for a learning focus. It's not, like kind of passing an exam, but to understand it better. So you could even have it as an after-school program or have small things included as part of your curriculum, these things. Or, you know, even teachers can talk about these issues to kids. So those are different ways in which, these gaps can be kind of plugged in.
Right. What are the plans for Gift Alexia?
So our focus is always children with specific learning disabilities, and, you know, how to get them to realize their true potential, so to say. So we're looking at working with more governments, developing the screening in more languages. And also during the pandemic, we've started on intervention. We would like to reach out to, a larger audience as far as intervention support is concerned, because most of the children with learning disabilities do find difficulty with reading. And so, phonetic training, especially when it comes to English language, which has a non-transparent orthography. The way you write and the way you speak, or the sound of letters, are very different. Letter combinations are different. Like, unlike most Indian languages, where the letter sound remains consistent throughout whatever combination you put the letters in. So a phonetic way of learning to read actually helps children a great deal in becoming independent readers. So, most schools do not follow this phonetic way of they still look at sight word reading, which children with learning disabilities really find difficult. So we are, focusing on our intervention strategies to help these children. So, that's some of our, immediate future plans.
Wonderful. Thanks a lot, Tina, for this wonderful conversation. It was very insightful.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the opportunity, Gautam, and wish you all the best for your future podcasts. And really appreciate you taking up, a topic like this. And I did listen to your previous podcasts as well. They were also very insightful. It's really kudos to you for doing something like this. I'm sure it helps a lot of parents and kids as well.
Thank you, Tina. Thanks for listening, and I'm sure you found it helpful. Please share it with parents and teachers that you know. I'll see you in the next episode.